So part one, so I'm going to start with part two. Before we pray, I just want to finish up what I was saying, the other gospel, going back to this. This is really important to understand the structure. And that's why our church, you'll notice, there's a three-year cycle. You know, we have a year of Mark, we have a year of Matthew, we have a year of Luke, you know, and we do have the other gospels depending. I don't have time to get into the whole, you know, structure of our liturgical year, but there's the focus of the three synoptics. But John doesn't have a year. John has a season. John has Lent and Easter. So you'll see John in Lent and Easter every year. There's heavy influence of John's gospel. Okay, so kind of remember that, the three synoptics, and then there's John. And then if you ever study theology, you got something called the gospel parallels. And it does this. It takes the scripture and it will put them next to each other and show comparisons. How are they similar? How are they different? And even when you read scripture yourself, you'll notice sometimes at the top of a reading, and I probably won't be able to find it quickly here because I want to find it right now. Oh, for example, in John's gospel, there's a passage here that says the Lamb of God, but you'll also see references to Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And it'll tell you where in those other gospels you'll see similar passages. So the connections are there between the four Gospels, but particularly between the first three, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Mark being the first to have been written, the shortest Gospel, and the others borrowed. Okay, so wasn't plagiarizing back then, but it was just sort of that coming together of tell the whole story. And there were other Gospels. These are the canonical Gospels, meaning when the church got together to decide to put together, you know, what is the official Bible. These were the canonical readings that made it. But there were others, and I'm going to read them to you because they're in this book here, my Gospel Parallel, and of course I can't get to, oh, there it is, non-canonical Gospels. So Gospel of the Ebonites, Gospel of the Hebrews, Gospel of the Egyptians, Gospel of the Nicaeans, Gospel of the Nazareans, Gospel of Peter, Acts of Philip, Gospel of Thomas, okay? So there's so much more. It's just really fascinating. If you study scripture, I fell in love with this. I was just like, I was a history major. I wasn't even thinking of doing theology. And then I fell into it. And it just was really, really, really fascinating, interesting, because it helped me make sense of my own life. When I started to study theology, I was like, oh, I get it now. I get how God plays in our lives, almost. I still have a lot to figure out. But it started to make sense, and I just found my passion by accident, and I loved it. I still love it. I'm retired, and this just really, you know, really does it for me when I get to talk about faith and theology and teach, and it's really a thrill. So I probably have forgot something, because there is so much to talk about when it comes to scripture, but I'm going to pray. Find my living with Christ. Just one thing about the Bible quiz. There was so much confusion. The first thing you guys are doing in this module is the Bible quiz. It's a self-assessment. You just take it to understand in your own sense of what you know, what you don't know. Don't have to post it. Don't have to share it. Don't have to send it to me. I will send you answers. And then you get an idea of like, oh, okay, I know this. Or, oh, I really don't know this. I have a lot to learn. That's all it is. Okay, try to make it simple for you guys. Anyways, so today's gospel is actually really great in terms of starting scripture, and it's taken from Matthew. So let's hold in our prayers today, everyone in our course that might be dealing with some kind of struggle. Candace's cousin was buried yesterday, celebration of life, so we continue to hold her in our prayers. And I know there's, I'm sure without even asking you guys, there are people that are dealing with all kinds of issues. So we hold our community in prayer, and we continue to pray with you and be there for you. And we pray for those boys that were rescued in Thailand and the tragedy of losing that one rescue worker. So we pray for his family that are mourning his loss, and then any prayer intentions you're holding in your heart, just think about it right now as we begin. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen, and peace be with you. A reading from Matthew's Gospel. As Jesus was walking along, a demonic who was mute was brought to him. You got to remember back then too, they didn't understand a lot about like mental illness and all kinds of things. Like even in terms of the geography, when you read, you know, the Old Testament, all there was floods and earthquakes and God's power. They didn't understand that the plates shifted in the earth, and you know, these forces of, you know, hot air, cold air, and like, so anything big and couldn't explain it, it was God. And it was often God was punishing them, right? Because everyone has a guilty conscience. We're all always doing something wrong. So we have a guilty conscience. And so this whole idea of this punishing God in the Old Testament or the Judaic scriptures was this sense of us dealing with our guilt as people and not understanding the force of nature and thinking it was God coming down on us, right? So when you hear about things like this, even in the New Testament, right, we think, you know, the demonic. Well, it was probably someone that was dealing with some sort of mental illness or other illnesses, right? Okay, let's get back to scripture. And when the demon had been cast out, the one who had been mute spoke. And the crowds were amazed and said, "Never has anything like this been seen in Israel." But the Pharisees said, "By the ruler of the demons, he cast out the demons." Then Jesus went about all the cities and the villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and cursing every disease and every sickness. When Jesus saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. And guess who the laborers are? It's us, Catholic education. Right? So in a lot of your posts, you were saying, you know, there's this triangle, church, parish, school. But as you know, more and more, more of that emphasis is going on to the school. Kids aren't going to their parish. The families are busy at home. There's more and more pressure and more responsibility for us in the Catholic schools to do so much more. That's why there's so much more demand on us. The sacrifice is just there by just the simply the way things are today. We have to take on so much more. We have to be mother, father, priest, teacher, friend, social worker. The list goes on and on. But in regards to faith, most of the responsibility is coming on to us. You know, if kids aren't going to school, who's giving them the gospel? I mean, if kids aren't going to church, yeah, they're not going to school either, some of them, but anyways, who's giving them the gospel? Who's being the model of faith? Who is showing them by their life, this is how you are a Christian? It's not shown by a collar. It's shown by you every day, everything you say, everything you do. You are a billboard for faith. Think about that. What are you advertising? Because just like media, you are the biggest advertiser of faith. Just like media is the bigger advertiser of secularity. We are responsible to find the sacred in the secular. We're not going to get rid of the secular world. It is there. It is strong. It is in everything. We need to find the sacredness in that everyday life for our kids. How do we find the sacred in the secular? And how do we minister to our students? Because that's our vocational call. We're not just teachers. We are ministering. Our ministry is our classroom. Think about it. That's pretty huge, but pretty awesome. It's pretty awesome. When you walk through the doors of your classroom every day, you are creating church. You are creating faith. You are creating community. You're creating a space where God's kingdom is being built. One child at a time, one soul at a time. Vatican II gave us that power as the laity. And in our baptism, we are all called to the priesthood. All of us are called to the priesthood through our baptism. The formality of the priesthood, the collar, the ordination is a higher level calling that involves a huge sacrifice for the priests, our sisters and nuns, our brothers. But we are also called to the priesthood. Are we ready? Let's see. Enjoy scripture. I'm going to enjoy reading your posts. And let's keep going. Peace.